Hello everyone, welcome to St. Silas Online in Phase 2. We're getting closer to seeing each other again properly. But I know that the closer we get to normality, the more frustrating this can feel for us. And perhaps the most frustrating thing is actually these virtual services. Maybe our desire for something other than God at this time might be the highest it's ever been. But as long as we keep gathering the best way we can to encourage and love one another the best way we can, and most importantly, hear God speak through his saving word, if we endure and keep at this, we can have faith that God's love will see us through. Now I'm going to share a few words from the Bible. They'll be familiar to most of us, but they'll still be comforting and as refreshing as the first time we heard them. The words of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Before we sing our first song about God's saving love, let us pray. Father, we are so thankful that you are gracious, compassionate, slow to anger, and rich in love. You are trustworthy, you are faithful. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. This morning we ask that you help us to be abiding in the love that you have for us. Help us to love one another as you have taught us to do. We ask that the Spirit helps us to hear you speak this morning and to pray with a soft heart and to listen with open ears. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Shall ever be how marvelous, how shall see.
Before our song, I reminded us of the words of John 3:16. This beautiful truth should remind us of God's full expression of his love and encourage us, but so often we get distracted. We seek comfort and forgiveness in other places. Sometimes we can even try to worship God in other ways than through his saving word in the Bible. And we know that this leaves us feeling dry, feeling hungry, and restless. But when this has happened, we can turn to God, we can tell him what has happened, and we can ask for his forgiveness. And then he provides a path back to loving and enjoying his gospel message, the full expression of his love for us, back to a life of fruitfulness as we remember what Jesus did at the cross. So if you are willing, please say the words in bold. God our Father, we come to you in sorrow for our sins, for turning away from you and ignoring your will for our lives. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us, for behaving just as we wish without thinking of you. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us, for failing you by what we do and think and say. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us, for letting ourselves be drawn away from you by temptations in the world about us. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us, for living as if we were ashamed to belong to your Son. Father, forgive us, save us, and help us. Now, hear the words of comfort Jesus Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. And the words that I read earlier, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And now we say together that beautiful prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Before Martin comes to preach to us, we have two Bible readings, and in between that, we have our church family focus with Ems, and we also have another song.
Our first scripture reading is taken from the book of Psalms. Psalm 145, beginning at verse 8. Psalm 145, at verse 8. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, long-suffering and ever faithful. The Lord is good to all. His compassion rests upon all his creatures. All your creatures praise you, Lord, and your loyal servants bless you. They talk of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your might, to make known to mankind your mighty deeds, the glorious majesty of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. In all his promises, the Lord keeps faith. He's unchanging in all his works. The Lord supports all who stumble and raises all who are bowed down. All raise their eyes to you in hope, and you give them their food when it is due. You open your hand and satisfy every living creature with your favor. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, faithful in all that he does. The Lord is near to all who call upon him, to all who call to him in sincerity. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He hears their cry for help and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but the wicked he will utterly destroy. My tongue will declare the praises of the Lord, and all people will bless his holy name for ever and ever. Amen.
We are just wanting to talk to Alice and Lucy here now. Obviously it's the summer months and we're saying goodbye to lots of different people, some more permanently and some more temporarily, like Alice and Lucy, but we thought it would be good to hear from them and then to pray for them, and then you guys can be praying for them for the summer months going forward and then the term ahead. So if we just start with you, Alice, and you just tell us, where are you going? What are you doing?
So I'm going to Edinburgh, going to Edinburgh University to study landscape architecture.
And what about you, Lucy? Where are you off to and what are you going to do?
I'm staying in Glasgow, so yeah, I'll still be around.
Not far.
To study human biology.
Oh, wow. And what sort of things then, if we start with you, Alice, are you looking forward to about it? Are you a bit nervous about?
I'm looking forward to meeting new people. And also just kind of living like with my own sort of rules, that like without my parents, you know. yeah, like finding my independence, yeah, and then just kind of finding a good church as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what about you, Lucy?
I'm kind of looking forward to just kind of going on to the next stage. And a bit more independence about like how you study and don't have people coming in on you all the time. So yeah, I'm just kind of looking forward to that, new experiences, meet new people. Yeah.
Are you going to be in halls or are you going to be living at home?
No, I'm going to be staying at home, at least for the first year, and then I'll maybe move out after that. I don't know. I'll see where things take me. But yeah, I'll probably be staying at home.
Yeah. And is there just like one thing particularly that you guys would like us to be praying for you for the coming year, coming term?
Probably just like that the transition is like smooth and it's as best it can be when it's all kind of, I mean, everything's a bit weird right now, and hopefully you can just kind of, yeah, just nice and fit in, like, well, even though we probably won't be able to see people or go and do certain things that, you know.
Mm-hmm. What about you, Alice?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, just like that it's as normal as it can be, and I can move into Edinburgh like as soon as I can, you know.
Well, Jenny, could you pray for the girls now? Oh, I should say we are hoping to give them a present. I have ordered some books for them, but they haven't quite arrived yet, so I can't show you the church family them. But we are going to be sending them off with something. But yeah, anyway, Jenny, why don't you pray for them now?
I'd be delighted. Now, I'm going to just say, congregation, you are going to pray with me. You don't get off on this one. We want to send you off together. So before I pray, I just want to ask those of you sitting on your sofas, those who know and those who don't know, Alice and Lucy, just to think about your first experience of university and of leaving home or staying home. What were you excited about? What were you nervous about? And what did you hope for? What did you not even know that you needed to be prepared for? And what words, scripture, song, things people said to you were encouraging to you at that time? And I just want to ask you to enter into prayer from that place of just remembering and being with these two as they begin this new season of life. So, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I thank you that you are here and that you have gone before Alice and Lucy to every place where they will go in life. And so, Alice and Lucy, may the Lord bless you with the easy breath of his Spirit and keep you under his wing of protection, body, soul, and spirit. The Lord make his face shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. May the Lord turn his face toward you, that you may know that in any place you go, he sees you. The Lord be gracious unto you, and may you rest in that grace every time you wander and come home. And may he give you peace that passes understanding and guards your hearts and your minds. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Fab, well, thank you for coming to speak to us today. And hopefully we'll see each other in person before you guys head off to university. That's great.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. To pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. I want to see you.
Today's reading is from John chapter 15, verses 9 to 14. That's John chapter 15, verse 9 to 14. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, and let me add my word of welcome to what's already been said. I'm delighted you could be with us this morning. My name is Martin Ayres. I'm the senior pastor at St. Silas Church. It's great you can be with us as we look at this topic, the love of God. There's actually a prayer in the Bible where the Apostle Paul says that he's praying for all the Lord's holy people in Ephesians chapter 3, that they would have the power of God to grasp the dimensions of the love of Christ for them. So it's a great way to open our time together in God's word here. Let's bow our heads and I'll lead us in that prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time and we ask that out of your glorious riches, you will strengthen us with power through your Spirit in our inner being, so that together with all your people, we might grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know that love that surpasses knowledge, that we might be filled to the measure with all the fullness of God. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, we've been in a series looking at knowing the living God. Some weeks have made us feel uncomfortable as we thought about last week God's sovereignty, that he's fully in control of everything. We thought about God's holiness, how he is frighteningly pure, that his holiness is a consuming fire. We thought about how God is working for his glory. It's been challenging. But this morning, if anything, we've got actually the opposite problem. It's that when it comes to thinking about the love of God, we are perhaps too comfortable. We think that we know it already. And we do, of course, hopefully, we know elements of God's love. But there are times when actually we're still in the shallow end and we need a deep end reflection on the love of God that is nonetheless challenging but helpful, so that we grow rich. We delve into the riches of God's love and our hearts are set ablaze by his love for us. So our first point this morning, the eternity of God's love. The Bible makes that profound statement, God is love. Love is so central to God's character, we can define him as love. The reason that is true is because God is love in eternity. What was God doing prior to creating the universe? He was literally in love. He exists forever in loving relationship within himself. That's only possible because of the Trinity, the three-in-oneness of God. That God the Father has always been a Father. He's always had a Son, and he's always loved the Son. God the Son has always been a Son, loving the Father. And that love has been in the unity of the Holy Spirit forever. When Jesus prays in the Garden of Gethsemane, the curtain is drawn back on that relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Spirit in John chapter 17. And we read this, John 17, 24. Jesus says, Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. And no other God is like this. One God, three persons. Allah cannot be love because he is unitary. He couldn't be love unless he was dependent on his creation. And a God A God can't be dependent on what they've made. But for Allah to be love, he would have had to create things in order to be who he essentially is. Because he'd have had to have something else or someone else to love. But the living God, the true God, because he is Father, Son, and Spirit, he exists in eternity in other person-centered loving relationship. He doesn't create people because he needs them. He creates them to share his love. If we picture the love of God like a fountain, then that fountain overflowed out from these eternal loving relationships, creating us so that we could share in that love and experience that love. In 1738, Jonathan Edwards, great American preacher, one of the greatest preachers of the English language, he preached a sermon, Heaven is a World of Love. And he takes up this picture of love like water. He describes rivers of love and delight in heaven, flowing out from God the Father's love for his Son in the Spirit. And Jonathan Edwards says this, these rivers of love and delight, listen to this, these rivers swell into an ocean of love in which the souls of the ransomed may bathe with the sweetest enjoyment and their hearts, as it were, be deluged with love. It's such a glorious picture, isn't it, of our future that the gospel has saved us for and that God is drawing us towards, that actually our souls, the souls of the ransomed, will bathe with the sweetest enjoyment in this ocean of love, being deluged with the love of God. Just think how different that is from the picture that atheists have, or people around us might have, of what God is like. The stingy, strict dictator who wants to spoil our fun, when actually God's revealed to us as the God of other person-centered delight and love. But as that love from within the persons of God flows out from them to us, how do we experience it? That's our second point, the complexity of God's love. It's complex. Who does God love? Well, in Psalm 145 that we had read for us, let's just look again at verse 13 from halfway through. It says, the Lord is faithful, the Lord is trustworthy in all he promises and faithful in all he does. The Lord upholds all who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them food. You give them their food at the proper time. You open your hand and satisfy the desires of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and loving towards all he has made. So across the world, every breath people take, every beat of their heart, every drop of rain, every rising of the sun, these are an expression of God's love for everyone. It's God's love that enables non-Christians to achieve such incredible greatness, to show such extraordinary acts of compassion. So we mustn't narrow God's love as though to say that, well, he only actually loves Christians. That's not true. God loves everyone. He loves everyone. And he loves the world even as it's rejecting him. So John 3:16, God so loved the world. Well, the world is the people God has made standing in rejection of him. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So he loves the world, he loves everyone enough to have offered out that opportunity to trust Jesus, not perish and have eternal life. We mustn't narrow God's love, he loves everyone. We also, though, we mustn't flatten God's love and think that God loves everyone in the same way. God has a universal love for all the people he's made, and at the same time he has a special love for people who turn to him and trust his promises. We heard last week about the sovereignty of God, that if we have turned to God, or we do turn to God, God, that's only because God has enabled us to do that. He is the one who opens our eyes to see who he is. He's the one who opens our hearts. The special love of God for those who turn to him is right there in the next verses of Psalm 145. So verse 18, the Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He hears their cry and saves them. The Lord watches over all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. So we mustn't narrow the love of God. He loves everyone. But God has a special love that is a saving love for everyone who turns to him. And it's just spelt out so well in those verses, isn't it? Verse 18, that when you trust God, he is near to you. He hears your cry. He satisfies your desires. Verse 20, he watches over you. These are the aspects of the special love of the relationship that God's people have with him whenever any of us turn to him and trust him. So it's complex. That's our second point, the complexity of God's love. And as we think about God's special love for those who trust him, let's come to our third point, the nature of God's love. What does it even mean to say that God loves us? It's not the same as human love for one another. So I'm going to think about a couple of aspects of that. The first is about love as a feeling. When we think about falling in love humanly, we're describing usually a feeling of attraction towards someone, a finding of them desirable, a thrill in getting to know them. When I was, I think, about 12, I liked a girl in my school, and I got a Valentine's Day card on Valentine's Day, and I opened it up, and when I opened it up, there inside was her name. And I felt this exhilarating feeling, this special glow of yes. It turned out that it had actually been written by one of my mates. It was a joke. It was quite a sad day. I am over it now. It's worked out fine. But the point is that there's this feeling that we sometimes describe as love, like the thrill of getting a card or of holding somebody's hand and them holding it back. But in fact, that can't be all there is to love. Partly because, I know this is quite hard to accept, but when you think about it, quite a lot of that feeling that we think of as love is actually just our own ego. It's just a thrill that we feel about ourselves because we discover that we are attractive to somebody else. Or it's selfish because we think we lack something that this other person could give us. So love becomes something born out of poverty in ourselves. We think, well, there's something empty in me, and I need this other person to fill that emptiness. So actually, it's about what this will give us. And the thing is, God's love would never be like that. For God is fully satisfied in himself. He doesn't need us. He doesn't need our praise. And that's a really good thing, because it means that his love for us is only ever selfless and pure. But there's another way of thinking about love that also needs correcting. The traditionalist sometimes hears about romantic love, sentimental love, and they say, oh, these days it's just all about feelings. That's not love. Love is about commitment. It's about sacrifice. It's about doing your duty. But there's a danger that that's a very incomplete understanding of love as well. You know, if I came home and said to my wife, Kathy, I brought flowers home, and I said, I've bought you flowers, Kathy. It is my duty. She's not going to feel very loved by that. There must be more to love than just a sense of, well, I did that because I was obliged to. It was my sense of duty. So what is love if it's not quite the same as the human feeling of romantic attraction? It's not quite that there's more to it than duty and obligation. Well, Jim Packer, again, in the book Knowing God, he helps us with this. He says this about love. He says, love is identifying yourself with the welfare of another. It's identifying yourself with the welfare of another. That is true love. So this is the astonishing, wonderful truth about God, that he has bound his heart with ours. Let me give you some scriptures that tell us about this mystery. Isaiah 63:9, talking about God's people, in all their distress, he too was distressed, and the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. Judges 10:16, then they got rid of the foreign gods among them and served the Lord, and he could bear Israel's sin, he could bear Israel's misery no longer. Hosea 11:8, as God's people suffer because they have turned from him and loved other things. He talks about their spiritual adultery, but he says this: how can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? My heart is changed within me. All my compassion is aroused. So God is speaking in the scriptures as though he is in want. He is grieved because his people are grieved. He's suffering anguish because they suffer anguish. And on the other hand, in Luke chapter 15, God tells us about the father and the lost son who's run away, and the lost son coming back to the father, picturing God and his people. And he says, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God when we turn back to him, over one sinner who repents. The presence of the angels of God. Who's in the presence of the angels of God? God is. God is rejoicing when we turn back to him. In Zephaniah 3:17, the Lord your God is with you. He's mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. It is weird and wonderful that God would love us like that. This is God who needs nothing and nobody. He has everything in eternity. He's self-sufficient. He depends on nobody for his happiness. And yet, he has voluntarily chosen to bind his heart to ours, to identify himself with our welfare. That's the essence of his love. So how far does that love go? That sharing our grief, that working for our joy? Well, that's our fourth point, the culmination of God's love. And you know where I'm going. The culmination of God's love starts with how we have not loved him. In the time of the prophet Hosea, God's people were, he calls them Ephraim, Israel, and Judah. And he says this about their love for him. This is so typical of human love for God. Hosea 6:4. What can I do with you, Ephraim? What can I do with you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that disappears. It's such a helpful picture, isn't it? Maybe you think of looking out over a field, maybe if you're in the mountains or you're camping or you're just looking over, looking out of your window in the morning and you see mist. And by kind of late morning, it's clear. The sun has burnt it through and heated things up and the mist just clears. That's what our hearts are like, even when we are trying to love God, that we take the good things from God. Sometimes our hearts feel warm towards him, but then we love those things too much and we forget God in our hearts. That is what our love is like for God. It affects our other relationships as well. There is a fickleness to human love. And then we read of a different love, 1 John chapter 4, verse 10. A love that meets our fickle love. 1 John 4:10. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. So where our love is fickle, God's love is faithful. It's unchanging, it's steadfast, it's constant, it's dependable, secure. Where our love is about getting, about what we can get, we love the things that give us things. God's love is about giving. It's sacrificial, even sending his son, who was the man Jesus on the cross, endures a broken relationship with his father. He is shut out from the love of his father that he's always known, as he bears the cost so that we can be welcomed back to God and restored. And that is, because the Son is fully God, that is God within himself fully absorbing the cost of the way we've treated him. You see that? Whenever we break a relationship or damage a relationship, there is a cost to bear. and God in himself absorbs that cost for us at the cross. In the book Captain Corelli's Mandolin, there is at one point Captain Corelli is with his troops and they have to stand before a German firing squad. And as the firing begins, his sergeant, Carlo, who loves Captain Corelli, he steps sideways in front of Captain Corelli and he grabs Captain Corelli's wrists behind him and pulls him towards his back so that Corelli's just staring at the huge man's back as Carlo takes the bullets in his place. And then eventually Carlo falls backwards onto Captain Corelli. And the writer, Louis de Bernier, says this, that Captain Corelli lies underneath Carlo's fallen body, paralyzed by his weight, drenched utterly in his blood, stupefied by an act of love so incomprehensible and ineffable, so filled with divine madness. There we have a wonderful description of the love God's shown us at the cross, that it's incomprehensible, ineffable, and it's full of divine madness. Incomprehensible to us because we give our fleeting, fickle love at best to God, and God meets it with a love that radiates towards us with immense, constant, everlasting, faithful, sacrificial, reconciling affection, so that it's love that grips us and transforms us. It's love that you can build your life on because it will last forever. Don't build your identity on your achievements or on your health, your fitness, or on even on another human being's love for you. The Apostle Paul, having discovered this love for him, says this, "The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me." That's his identity. Christian, Jesus loved you. He gave himself for you. It's love to use as a lens through which to view your whole life. Have you thought about this? That when you look at the cross, you can trust that one day every moment of your life will be understandable in the context of God's steadfast, inexhaustible love for you. And it's love to inspire us that God's love for us is holy, it's pure, it's compassionate, he helps us because he loves us, and it's wise, always acting for our best. And God is a lover who calls us to love like him, to love faithfully, dependably, sacrificially, in our marriages, in our friendships, that we would be good friends who love our friends, that we would be faithful in our marriages, in our church family, that we would love sacrificially. 1 John 4:11, "Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." And Jesus in John 15, "My command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends." Could we keep praying about that, even in lockdown? Asking God to help us find ways to love others. Longing for the day that we can be with others without restriction again, not just to see the people we like, but actually so that we can love people who are not like us. We love others not because it's rewarding, not even because it's satisfying, not even because we find them lovable because they're like us, but rather because all the reward we need, all the energy we need to love others, comes from knowing how deeply we are loved by God. Let's pray together. We praise you, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, that you are the source of all love, that you are the bountiful, bottomless, inexhaustible fountain of love. And we thank you for choosing to direct that love towards us, identifying with us, that you would not spare your own Son, but gave him up for us all. Help us by your Spirit to ponder this love deeply, that our hearts would be deluged by it and would in turn overflow in practical, costly, joyful, life-transforming love for you and for others, that in turn draws others in to know your special saving love. We ask this for the glory of your name, the name of love. Amen. Well, we're going to sing in response, and we're going to pray as well. We're going to talk to God, and we're going to sing again. Our next song is one we've not sung before. It's a familiar tune, but this hymn was written by John Newton, who also wrote Amazing Grace. It is hard work, the words. It's poetry, poetic language. It's rewarding if you take the time to look at it. It's an appropriate one to sing that the New Scottish Hymns Band have recorded last week. And just wanted to draw your attention to it taking up that image that I used in the talk, Jonathan Edwards uses, of God's love as like a fountain. So in the second verse, see the streams of living waters springing from eternal love, well supply your sons and daughters, and all fear of want remove. Let's sing together of God's great love for his people.
Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God. He whose word cannot be broken formed thee for his own abode. On the rock of ages founded, what can shake thy sure repose? With salvation's walls surrounded, thou mayst smile at all thy foes. See the streams of living waters springing from eternal love. Well, supply thy sons and daughters, and all fear of want remove. Who can faint while such a river ever flows their thirst to assuage? Grace which like the Lord, the giver, never fails from age to age. Round each habitation hovering, see the cloud and fire appear for a glory and a covering, showing that the Lord is near. Thus deriving from their banner light by night and shade by day, safe they feed upon the manna which he gives them when they pray. Savior, if of Zion say, I through grace a member am, let the world deride or pity, I will glory in thy name. Fading is the worldling's pleasure, all his boasted pomp and show. So Zion's children know.
Let's pray together. Father God, we come to you at this difficult time, and we ask that you would help us to pray for the needs of the world and for the needs of our neighbours and friends and family, and for our own needs. This time of lockdown brings up many issues, as the normal things in our lives are put on pause or taken away altogether. We ask that you would help us to bring our struggles and frustrations, our worries and anxieties to you. Thank you, Father God, that you care for us and love us, even when we don't feel that we are doing very well. Thank you, Father God, that none of the things that we go through in our lives are wasted by you. And you want to shine your light into the dark places in our lives, to restore us and renew your life in us. We pray for this world and we thank you for the ways that we can see your hand at work. We thank you for the many people who are tuning in to online services and who wouldn't normally come to church. We thank you that people are buying Bibles and thinking about prayer. We ask, Father God, that you would be at work in people's hearts and minds as they turn to you. We pray that they would come to know Jesus, the light of the world. We pray as we have conversations with our neighbours and friends that you would give us wisdom and boldness to share our faith. We pray that the relationships and friendships that have started during lockdown would continue. We pray for our governments and our leaders that you would guide them as they make decisions about the best way to ease the lockdown. And we continue to pray for all those working in the NHS, for energy, resilience, patience and compassion. And we thank you for the progress being made to develop a vaccine. And we pray that you would continue to guide those involved in this work. We pray for St. Silas. We pray for wisdom for Martin and the ministry team and vestry as we consider how we can do church together as restrictions begin to be lifted. We thank you for our annual business meeting this past week. We thank you for the vestry members who have served over the past few years and who have now stepped down. For Gordon, Ali, Michael, Morag and Darren. And also for Heather, our vestry clerk. We pray for those who are continuing to serve, for Fiona, Ian and Nathan. And we give you thanks for the new folk who will be coming on to vestry. For Warren, Robin, Donald John, Sarah and Sarah. And for Derek, taking over as our clerk. We pray for vision and for unity and for wisdom as they make decisions. We thank you, God, that you are the God of all comfort. Thank you for your Holy Spirit, the Comforter. And we pray for those in our church family who are unwell just now, those who are worried or anxious, those who have recently been bereaved, and those who are struggling in their faith. May you draw close to each one of us, and may you be the lifter of our head. Help us to be ever mindful that we are completely loved, accepted, forgiven, and restored through your Son, Jesus, and help us to live each day in light of this truth. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Well, let's lift up our heads and open our eyes after that time of prayer. Now, I don't know about you, but I thoroughly enjoyed the annual business meeting this week. Probably because it was my first church ABM. I think that'll help. But I think, yeah, plenty of good professional business and also plenty to smile about. And if you're new to St. Silas, that's kind of our vibe. Professional, but plenty to smile about. Now, for church notices, just a wee reminder that our growth groups and our roots groups return this Wednesday. And next Wednesday, the following one, we have our central prayer meeting. So now, I think you will remember last week that Jack met with some people who are going into Relay. If you missed that, you can catch it on our YouTube page. But this week, I met with Josh and Sarah Stocks, who have invited us into their home virtually, and they share some of what life has been like for them in recent months.
Hello, St. Silas. This morning we're with Josh and Sarah. And so I thought, so Josh, Sarah, in case anyone's not met you before, do you want to give us a brief introduction to who you are and what you do?
So I'm Sarah. This is my husband, Josh. We moved to Glasgow about 3 years ago so that I could come and work as a doctor in the beat scene. So we've been coming since I was pretty much since then.
And I'm working as a call handler for the ambulance service. So I answer 999 calls, which is an interesting job, if somewhat challenging.
Which you've also just started in the middle of lockdown.
We started that in the middle of lockdown. So that's been interesting. Do a new job in the middle of all of the current madness.
Great. Okay. Thanks. Well, so when there's an opportunity to do things differently, I like to, and this is one of those days. So we're going to try and bring back a sort of empty cribs vibes. So as you guys take us around your crib, why don't you explain like why we're doing this and just how it's going?
Okay. So Josh, having only just started his job, had a lot of projects to do because we also moved into our new house just in August time.
So we tiled our floor and we did the entrance. It's not quite finished, but we're almost there. And then we did some more work. So I have been laying some floor and doing some finishing. So we laid some nice bamboo in our new house. And we finished that all up and got the door thresholds down, which had been quite frustrating to not get done. And then we did our kitchen. So the kitchen was untiled, and there's still a few bits that aren't quite finished, but I did most of the tiling in lockdown. So that took me a couple of weeks to do all of those jobs before I started my new job. So that's something different and interesting that we did with lockdown, which was good fun. A bit of a learning experience. Tile cutting is odd when you don't have a power tool and you can't steal one from your father, which is what I used to do because he has a great collection, but you're not allowed to do that in lockdown. So yeah, that is our house.
So welcome.
Looks much tidier than it normally does.
That's great. That's amazing. What a thing to be doing in lockdown.
Yes, I think it's busy.
Definitely get me busy. Well, I didn't. So I worked in retail before I did the current thing that I'm doing. So obviously that all closed down with lockdown. So finding something to do that was useful was important and good.
Yeah, I think grabbing hold of some sort of purpose or something to structure your days seems to be the most helpful thing. Other than Jesus, during lockdown, Cool. Why don't we spend a couple of minutes just talking about things that you have found helpful or things that you've found difficult during lockdown?
So I think for us, probably both of us, I think the thing that's been really helpful actually is how is our lovely Roots group and actually just the fact that we can meet all together online, even though it's not quite the same. I think it's been a real encouragement, and just that people have stuck with it as well, I think has been just a real blessing to have that kind of fellowship, even if it is remotely.
Thursday guys have been really good. We've had some people coming in, connecting every week from Belgium, a few from Poland, so that's been good fun. And it's been good to see them. They've been really helpful for us, and I think working through like Bible studies with them and praying with them, That's been really good because it's given us just one more thing to anchor the week around. So we haven't lost on the team, we haven't lost what we're doing.
That's amazing. Yeah. Is there anything we can be praying for you as a congregation at this time?
My new job is, we're still on the learning curve for that. That's quite stressful. And if you could be praying for our Roots guys, especially over the summer, the Roots kind of formal teaching is coming to an end. We're finishing up Revelation next week, and then that's kind of it for the summer. So we're looking at how to just be with those guys and help them and make sure that they are being looked after during the summer months when the lockdown might not yet be lifted. So just pray for them. That'd be really good.
And I think just, I guess, for probably for both of us, that we could be, because it is a strange time and it is weird, so even if you are going to work every day, which we both are, it's still, it's not the same. So being able to be a good witness and be a kind of, you know, clearly a Christian in a different environment, I think would be really good.
Great. Okay, cool. Perhaps I can pray for you just now, and then we'll go on with our days. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Josh and Sarah, for all the work that you're doing in them and all the way that they're serving at St. Silas. We pray for their roots group, and the way that they are getting into Revelation. We pray for them as your children, that they grow in your grace, that they be good witnesses, and help with the spread of your kingdom. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And we should say a big thank you for getting up so early. It's actually like 8 a.m., crazy time, and you've now got work. So big thanks to that.
It was nice to see you, Rob. Thank you, Rob.
Thanks.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me bold again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow.
Nothing but the blood.
Well, we've now reached the end of our service. We will go on to be in our fellowship groups. But before then, let me lead us in a time of prayer. Father, we thank you for this time this morning to gather together virtually to hear you speak. We thank you for your love for us, and for the way you have expressed it by sending your Son. We thank you for such a clear commandment to love each other. We ask for the Spirit's help in this, and we also ask for forgiveness when we fail. Help us to have fruitful conversations in our time of fellowship after the service. May your love fill all our days with joy and our nights with peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, we have another service at 6:30 p.m. this evening, but we will be back again at 11 a.m. next week. Take care.